Greetings, my dear brothers and sisters. I greet you all in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our God is faithful and our God does marvelous things for us. Hallelujah. That's why Deuteronomy says, therefore know that the Lord your God, He is God. He is the faithful God. He is the one who keeps all your covenants and all your mercies. And for 1,000 generations, those who love Him will always reign with Him because you have kept His commandments. Hallelujah. My Jesus, you have a great hand and you have a mighty hand. And there is no God in heaven and earth who can do anything like your works, my Lord. And your mighty deeds will be remembered. And Lord, they will be proclaimed through the ends of the earth. My Jesus, you are the rock and you are my fortress. And for your name's sake, you have led us and you have guided us. And Lord, we remember that you are the rock. Yes, my Jesus, there is no one like you. There is no one holy like the Lord our God. And there is none besides you. And there is no rock like our God. For the Lord is my rock, He is my fortress and my deliverer. And Paul also confirms that in 1 Corinthians. It says, no one can lay a foundation other than the one that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I mean, because Jesus Christ is our chief cornerstone, the rock who will fill us with His living waters. Hallelujah. And the same living waters which the Israelites drank when they crossed with Moses, when they crossed the Red Sea, that same spiritual rock is there with us today. And that rock is claimed as the rock will be Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. That rock is none other than Jesus Christ. Amen. So there is no rock, there is no God like our God. This is the rock of ages whom we are singing about. And this rock of ages, who is the Father God and Jesus Christ, is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. Amen. Let us declare our praises to Him. There is no rock like our God. There is no rock like our God. Jesus is our salvation.
There is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved, He's proven Himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like our God. Salvation that cannot be moved, He's proven Himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like us. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of salvation that cannot be moved, He's proven Himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like us. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like us. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's no rock like Jesus Christ. There's no God like our God. And we're going to just worship this God for the next 5 to 10 minutes. Let me all ask you to consider everything that is in us and present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to the Lord our God, our Maker. And this will be our spiritual worship. Amen. Because remember that we have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer we that lives in ourselves, but it is the Spirit of God, that is Jesus Christ, who lives in us. Hallelujah. Let that be our desire right now. Because let us call out for insight. Let us call out for the voice of understanding. Because Jesus is that voice of understanding. And seek it like silver. Seek it like hidden treasures. And then you will understand and know that the Lord our God is good. And then you will fear the Lord God and get into the knowledge of the Lord our God, our Maker. Hallelujah. So let us seek the Lord like a hidden treasure right now. Submit ourselves to the presence of the Lord. And put your name on the list of the Lord's hands and know that you've not been forsaken, know that you've not been struck out, know that you've not dwindled in this world, but the Lord has lifted you up and He has uplifted your name amongst all the adversaries that are around us. And the Lord at this time, He draws us closer to His presence. And then if we are raised with Christ, yes, the Lord is raising us just like He raised Christ. So let us seek the things which are above and not the things of this world. And let us come before the Lord our God with a glory, with a radiance in our face that will resemble the glory of the Lord God when He sits on the Father's throne. And let that be the same glory that we earn for. Let that be the same glory that we strive for. Because that is a glory that will take us to the highest of the highest place. And let our praises reach to the highest. Amen. So let us put to death everything that is in us. Everything that is in us. Let us put it to death. And let us come to the Lord our God. And ask the Lord, Lord, here I am. I'm presenting you my body as a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable to you, my Jesus. This is our desire. To worship you, Lord. I give you all of my heart, all of my soul, and everything that I am, Lord Jesus. You take it, Lord. For you have to live with me. In Jesus' name. This is my desire to honor you, my Lord. Lord, with all of my heart, I will worship you. And all I have within me, I give unto you. And all that I adore is in you, my Lord. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart I worship you. All I have within me, I give
desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away. Lord, have your
Jesus, have your way in us, Lord Father. Not my ways, Lord Father, but Lord, let your ways, Lord Jesus, let your ways be the light unto my path, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for bringing us out of darkness. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you're revealing unto us. And in these last days, Lord Father, to come to the knowledge of the Son is the most important thing. And Lord, we surrender ourselves to the word of God that's going to be spoken. And may the Spirit of truth, may the Spirit of Christ, may your Holy Spirit, and may the Spirit of God, may it lead us, enlighten us, and bring us to find all the treasures that you kept for us. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, my Lord.
Today's Bible reading is taken from John chapter 15, verse 1 to 8. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that he may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit of itself, unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you, unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch, and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burnt. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. Amen.
Greetings, dear brothers and sisters, in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I believe the time of worship was a blessing to you all. And let us tune into the Word of God. And may I ask you all to just close your eyes, that the meditation of our hearts and the words that come out of our mouth will be pleasing and acceptable in the eyes of the Lord. Amen. My Jesus, my Redeemer, my Savior, let Him lead us in all the ways in which we are chosen to be bearers of the words of truth. Amen. Thank you, Lord. And let's go today's topic. Today, I want to talk to you about the Spirit of Truth. Yes, the Spirit of Truth is found in John chapter 14 to chapter 16. These chapters, John chapter 14 to 16, are some of the confusing chapters in the Word of God, and there are many interpretations. And these are the chapters in which we see a wide variety of figurative speeches by the Lord Jesus Christ. But before we step into it, let us all understand how the various churches and how the theologies teach about the Spirit of Truth, which is mentioned between the Gospel of John chapter 14 and 16. The first group of people, that is the most common teaching in the churches today, is that this Spirit of Truth is just another name for the third person in the Holy Trinity, that is the Holy Spirit, whom will be sent to us. So this Spirit of Truth is nothing but just another name for the Holy Spirit. And there is a second group of people who teach that this Spirit of Truth is only a testifying spirit regarding Jesus Christ. Yes, because Jesus said that there will be a spirit that will be coming that will testify about him. So using that verse, they claim that there are many spirits of God. If you turn to the book of Revelations, there are seven spirits of God which are before the throne of God. But these are not seven spirits, means not seven different distinct personalities of God. No, they are the same and the only spirit. Just the manifestation is different. But these group of people claim that this Spirit of Truth is one of the spirits of God. I mean, but John 4:24 clearly says that God is a spirit, a single spirit. Previous weeks we have seen it. And when there is a single spirit, suddenly that one spirit, that God is a spirit, cannot become multiple spirits. Amen. Now, another teaching is that the Spirit of Truth is just a power that is of God and a power that belongs to God. The Spirit of Truth is just a power. And having seen some of the interpretations of the many churches and the many theologies available in the world today, let us look at the first reference we see to the Spirit of Truth, where we find it in John chapter 14 and verse 16. And here we're going to read step by step, because I'm going to be meditating probably on John chapter 14 today, and maybe in a series of parts, maybe two or three parts, as the Lord leads, we will be expanding on the study. So pay much attention. I'm trying to be as slow as possible so that we can all understand. John chapter 14 and verse 16. And it says, I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. Amen. So here it says that I will pray the Father. Jesus is going to pray to the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. I told you this entire 14, 15, 16, these chapters are full of figurative speeches. And unless we question and verify with the Word of God, we'll never be able to come to the light of the Lord. So read the verses as it is, and let us ask the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord in us, to interpret each and every verse. Amen. So before I come to John chapter 14, verse 1 to 13, we see in John chapter 13, Jesus is seen assuring and comforting his disciples because they still did not have the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. They did not fully comprehend the mystery of God, which is of the Father and of the Son. Yes, Colossians 2 and verse 2 and 3 says, the full assurance of understanding to the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Amen. There is a mystery of God. The apostles, when they were with Jesus, they could not comprehend the figurative language of Jesus, but the apostles grew from that. So this is the mystery of God, which they did not have a revelation about when Jesus was with them. And many of those words that Jesus spoke brought trouble into their hearts. That's why we see in John chapter 13, Jesus is assuring and comforting his disciples. And remember this mystery of God, which was not revealed to the disciples. Jesus only revealed it to a few disciples like Peter, James and John, where they were on the mount where Jesus was transfigured. But still they did not fully comprehend him. And they did not understand till a later part that Jesus himself was the bearer of the Spirit of the Father God, and that he was their everlasting Father, according to Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. Yes, Jesus spoke in a complete figurative language, and that is something very strangely I find that many churches and many teachers of the Word of God are not willing to understand or accept. Yes, Jesus spoke in a figurative language, but you see many churches and teachers of the Word of God, they will never agree to it. So what I'm going to do first, before we start with John chapter 14, I'm going to talk to you regarding the mysterious language of Jesus Christ. That is a figurative language of Jesus Christ. And when he did his ministry in the world, he spoke in a figurative language, and many people around him, they could not comprehend it. They could not understand it. But we have to understand what is the figurative language of Jesus before we start meditating upon the Spirit of Truth found in John chapter 14. The reason, without this mysterious language, we will be lost in the dark and we cannot understand and read the Word of God in its light. Amen. So John chapter 16 verses 25 and 26 very clearly says, Jesus himself is saying these words. These things. What things? This is John chapter 16. Remember, this is John chapter 16 after 14, 15 and 16, which we're going to meditate. And he's saying, these things I've spoken to you in figurative language, but the time is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figurative language, but I will tell you plainly about the Father. So all these times when Jesus was explaining about the Father and the Son, he was talking to them in figurative language, and Jesus is saying, there will come a time when I will not speak to you in this mysterious language, but I will tell you plainly about the Father. In that day when you will ask in my name, I do not say that I shall pray the Father for you. But many churches and teachers of law will not agree to this at all, because this very clearly says, these things I have spoken to you. What are these things? These are what has happened before, what Jesus spoke before in John chapter 14, 15 and 16. All these things Jesus is saying, I've spoken to you in a figurative language. And these are what we're going to meditate upon this week and the next few weeks. Now, many people, they say that this figurative language was only reserved for the parables that Jesus spoke to explain the gospel. All the stories and parables that Jesus said. But I have to humbly decline that explanation, because these figurative languages that Jesus spoke was not regarding the parables or stories that he preached, but rather the mystery of God and the mysteries concerning the kingdom of God. That is why we see in Matthew chapter 13, after Jesus had preached the parable of the sower. This parable of the sower is a very significant parable, because Jesus is using this opportunity to make sure that the word of God is comprehended well and the mysteries understood, and that every word that proceeds from the word of God will fall on good ground and it will produce a good harvest. So after the parable of the sower, the disciples questioned him. In Matthew chapter 13 and verse 10 to 11, the disciples came and said to him, "Why, Lord, do you speak to us in parables?" But Jesus answered and said to them, "Because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them," to those people who never understood, "to them it has not been given." Here Jesus is making a division. People who understand, people who do not understand. And this very clearly says, "It has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven." Clearly says, this is regarding the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, not stories, not the parables, but the mystery of God himself, which we read in Colossians chapter 2 and verses 2 and 3. The mystery of God, of both the Father and of Christ. And regarding this mystery only, Jesus is saying that we should not be ignorant. Because if we are ignorant of this mystery, then spiritual blindness will creep into us. We have to be really careful. That's what Paul is saying in Romans chapter 11 and verse 25. For I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinions, that blindness in part has happened to Israel. Amen. This is Paul is saying that we should not be ignorant of this mystery that Jesus is talking about, the mystery of the kingdom of God, that we should not be wise in our own opinion and keep it all away. But when you do that, blindness in part will happen to Israel. That has happened to Israel will happen to you as well. Amen. So this figurative language of Jesus Christ is not of these parables or stories, but a much higher teaching about the mysteries concerning God and His kingdom. Amen. So churches, teachers of the Word of God, all believers, brothers and sisters, step out of your standpoint and do not deny anymore that Jesus did use this figurative language in His teachings. Do not deny that. Because if you keep ignoring this figurative language, God is warning that you will come into the spiritual blindness, and that spiritual blindness will be forever. And this is exactly what Jesus Himself is referencing the prophecy of Isaiah to warn us of, a spiritual blindness. Listen till the end of this passage that we're going to read, because there is a wonderful revelation of the Lord there. Matthew chapter 13 and verse 14 to 17. Jesus is echoing the prophet Isaiah here, and this is a warning to all the dear believers in the Word of God. So listen to this carefully. It says in the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, hearing you will hear and shall not understand, and seeing you will see and will not perceive. Whom does it talk about? People who have known God. For their hearts of these people have grown dull, their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes have been closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn, so that I can heal them. Hallelujah. This is what the Lord wants. He wants us to come out of the spiritual blindness, and He wants to understand the figurative language of the Lord, that we'll understand the mysteries of the kingdom of God, which Jesus told the disciples, unto you has been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, not unto them. Do not be like the people whom Jesus discarded, but become the people whom Jesus selected and made known unto them the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, which He spoke in a figurative language. And that is what verse 16 says, but blessed are your eyes that they see, and your ears that they hear. Hallelujah. That is exactly what God wants to do with us. For assuredly I say to you, listen to this verse very carefully, a wonderful revelation. For assuredly I say to you that many prophets and righteous men desired to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear. What did the prophets and righteous men desire to see? You see the book of Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, you look at Psalms, everyone, they wrote about the day of the Lord. And this is what many prophets and righteous men desire to see. And what is that day of the Lord? Zephaniah chapter 1 and verse 7 says, be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is near. And what is going to happen on the day of the Lord? The Lord has prepared a sacrifice and consecrated His guests. Hallelujah. Who's preparing a sacrifice? The Lord God. Who's? Jesus Christ Himself is preparing a sacrifice and consecrated. What? The anointing of the oil, the consecration of the guest. Guest means whoever believes and comes unto Jesus Christ are called the guest. And the Lord has prepared a sacrifice for them, and He Himself is anointing them with holy oil. Hallelujah. So the day of the Lord means the appearing of the Lord God Yahweh as Savior in the flesh. And only a few like Abraham saw why Jesus Himself is only a few like Abraham, righteous people like Abraham saw this. And that is what Jesus Himself is proclaiming in John chapter 8 and verse 56. Your father Abraham He rejoiced to see my day. Whose day? My day. And he saw it and he was glad. How can Abraham had seen the day of the Lord? But Genesis chapter 18, go read what has happened there. Three angels came. One was the Lord God. So who was that Lord God? According to John chapter 8, 56, the Lord God Yahweh, Jesus is claiming that Abraham rejoiced and saw my day. Whose day? The Lord Jesus Christ's day. And this is exactly what Jesus is saying, that many prophets and righteous men desired to see what you see, but did not see it, but you are seeing it. The prophets and righteous men desired to see the day of the Lord, when the Lord God Yahweh will come as a savior. They did not see it, but the disciples, they saw it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, this Jesus Christ reduced his glory and appeared to Abraham. He came as a flesh because he ate beef, butter and milk. That's what the word of God says. Amen. And this is the summary that the Apostle Peter regarding the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ is writing in 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 10 to 12. Let us read this very carefully because I'm going to be slow on this. Read it. Of this salvation, the prophets have inquired and searched carefully. Who prophesied of the grace that will come to you, searching what or what manner of time? The Spirit of Christ who was in them. Where was the Spirit of Christ? The Spirit of Christ was inside the prophets. Now, where were the prophets? Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, Zephaniah, Hosea. They were all in the Old Testament. But whose spirit did they have? The Spirit of Christ who was in them, who was indicating when he testified before the sufferings of Christ and the glories that will follow. And what is it saying over here? The Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicating when he testified. He testified. Who's that he? That he is no other but the Lord God Yahweh, the Father God. So who's that Spirit of Christ? The Spirit of Christ is none other than the Father God. Hallelujah. And the next verse it says, to them it was revealed, not to themselves, but to us they were ministering the things. To them it was revealed means what was revealed? Revealed that the Christ will have the Spirit of Lord in him. It was revealed unto them. And then it was revealed unto the apostles as well. That is why the apostles were still in the dark in John chapter 13. They could not understand, they could not comprehend the mysteries of God. But only at a later time, it was revealed unto themselves as well. Hallelujah. And it says, ministering the things which now has been reported to you through these who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Things which angels desire to look into. Be very careful. I'm going to read it again. Reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Now, who's preaching the gospel here? The Holy Spirit from heaven. But who preached the gospel to us? Who preached the gospel to us? Firstly, let's see Isaiah. In Isaiah, we see that the Lord God is talking regarding the New Jerusalem in Isaiah chapter 52. And the New Jerusalem means the church of God. And he's talking about the day of the Lord and about Zion, which is the holy spiritual mountain of God. So you must understand that whatever Isaiah is speaking in Isaiah chapter 52 is not for the Old Testament, but for the New Testament, for the coming day of the Lord. And Isaiah chapter 52 verse 5 and 6, we're going to read it. Now therefore, what have I here, says the Lord, that my people are taken away for nothing. Here the Lord is making a statement that my people are taken away for nothing. This echoes Hosea chapter 4 and verse 6, where the word of God says, my people are destroyed from lack of knowledge. That is what the Lord is saying here. My people are taken for nothing. It's not a big crime to have a lack of knowledge, but it has destroyed them. Let's continue reading Isaiah. Those who rule over them make them wail, says the Lord, and my name is blasphemed continually every day. Yes, the Lord is warning that this will be the condition of the churches in the end of days, that his name will be blasphemed. That is happening right now in all the churches. And verse 6 says, therefore my people shall know my name. Hallelujah. Who's saying? The Lord God Yahweh is saying, therefore my people shall know my name. And what was the Lord God Yahweh's name? It was not given. So what was the name he's talking about? The name of Jesus, which is my name, says the Lord God Yahweh. Yes, Jesus is bringing the church to the knowledge of the Father and the Son. And remember, he's making his name known as the omnipotent God and not a triune God. This is the mystery of the God, of which is both the Father and the Son. Colossians chapter 2. His name is of an omnipotent God, not a triune God. If you have a triune God, you should have three names for each three persons. But that's not the case. And come to the next part of the verse. Here it's where he's saying, therefore they shall know in that day. Who's saying? The Lord God Yahweh saying, therefore they shall know in that day that I am he who speaks. Behold, it is I. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who's saying this? The Lord God Yahweh saying that I am he who speaks. We read in the earlier chapter where we read it, that 1 Peter verse 1, that the Holy Spirit has been sent from heaven to preach the gospel unto you. But here the Lord God Yahweh is saying that who's preaching? That I am the one who speaks to you. Behold, it is I. Hallelujah. And he has a name. And what is that name? His name is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit, which preaches the gospel, is none other than the Lord God Yahweh himself. It is the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. And this I am he who speaks is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ, who proclaimed the gospel to the entire world. It was Jesus who spoke, and it was Jesus who was declared to be in the bosom of the Father, meaning he was in the Spirit of God. He was in the Spirit of God means the bosom of the Father. That's what Jesus himself is proclaiming. John chapter 14 and 6, Jesus is preaching, I am he who speaks, is that Lord God Yahweh who came in flesh and manifested, and Jesus is preaching, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Hallelujah. It was not a Holy Spirit, not a third person, not a first person, not a second person. It was the one omnipotent Lord God Yahweh who said that he will speak to his people, is speaking to his people that I am the way, the truth, and the life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And no one comes to the Father except through me. So what does this mean? Many people misunderstand this. No one comes to the bosom of the Father, where Jesus has prepared a place for us. Bosom means the Spirit of the Lord. Spirit of the Lord means the kingdom of God in us. Listen to the previous 2 weeks sermon. We read about it. The Spirit of the Lord upon you means God is bestowing upon you a kingdom. So this verse should actually read that John chapter 14, 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the kingdom of God except through me. Hallelujah. Do you understand that? And that is why 1 Peter chapter 1, 12 says at the end, this is the mighty mystery that even angels desire to look into. Hallelujah. Angels, they desire to look into this mystery. Hallelujah, because these are not the mysteries of just some stories and parables. These are the mysteries concerning the kingdom of God, the heavenly kingdoms. That is why we see Jesus himself proclaiming in a figurative language that the Father is the one speaking through him. John chapter 12 verses 49 to 50. For I have not spoken of my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his command is everlasting life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak. Here we see that it's a figurative language, but with all literary sense, we will probably understand that there are two people over here. But you have to question yourself in each of these figurative phrases used by the Lord Jesus Christ. Because I'm asking you, if Jesus and the Father are two distinct persons and two equal in God nature, then why should one person command another? Have you thought about it? If you claim that it's a triune God and they work together as in a machine, as one cog, then why should one person command the other? Think about it. Because I want you to keep questioning each and every figurative language, and only then you'll come into the truth. Anyway, let's find out, what is this command that Jesus is talking about here? What is this command? So who commanded us everlasting life? Now Jesus spoke in a figurative language. And regarding this everlasting life, there are many verses that have been spoken by the Lord Jesus Christ. We see John chapter 3 verse 16, famous. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son to whoever believes in him. So he gave his only son to whoever believes in the Father. That's what everybody thinks. That whoever believes in Jesus Christ, that he will not perish but have eternal life. John chapter 6 and verse 40. This is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes him should have eternal life. Whose will is it? The Father's will. The Father is commanding over here. John chapter 5 and verse 24. Truly, truly I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. This is Jesus talking. And Jesus is saying, whoever believes him who sent me will have eternal life. Amen. But all these commands seem to be given by a father to a son, Jesus Christ. We see that at the end of days, this is where Jesus is speaking to you. Be very careful. These are all the figurative language of Jesus. You understand, the audience for all these figurative language was the Jews mostly. The Lord wanted to bring a spiritual blindness unto them so that the fullness of the Gentiles will come in. So though all these commands seem like commands given by a father to a son, still in the end of days, we see that the only person who can command everlasting life to us is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Amen. Revelations chapter 2 and verse 7 says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give, who's saying? The Lord Jesus Christ. I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of paradise of God. Hallelujah. What is this? The same tree of life that was in the Garden of Eden. There were two trees there. A tree of life, a tree of knowledge. But here we see that Jesus is saying, I will give to eat from the tree of life. Now many people will say, no, Jesus never said it. It's the Spirit. Now what are these spirits? Spirit is the seven spirits which are before the throne. You read Revelation chapter 1. And 1 Corinthians 12 says, it is the same Lord, the same Spirit, the same God, but they're all diversities in the working of the same God. We saw this in a previous sermon as well. Because they are the diversities in the working of the same God, but it's the same Spirit. And who is that Spirit? Jesus is in the midst of the seven churches. He's in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. You read Revelation chapter 1 and verse 2, chapter 1 and chapter 2. You'll understand that. And it's no other but Jesus who's in the midst of the seven churches, and he is proclaiming in the Spirit of the Lord that he will give unto us to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. So who is commanding everlasting life unto us over here? The Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we have to understand these figurative languages to completely understand and comprehend with the Spirit of the Lord and rightly divide the word of God in the Spirit and in the truth of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And just to get it a little bit more interesting, I want to throw you a language. I want to throw you a challenge. And to get a hang of this figurative language, this is a challenge I'm going to throw to you. John chapter 17 and verse 3, it says, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you sent. Read this carefully. Here it says, this is eternal life, that they may know you, who the Father, The only true God. It claims that the Father is the only true God and Jesus Christ whom you send. So this verse talks about two people and it says the only true God is the Father God. And Jesus Christ is either a person or a Lord or somebody who is sent. So if you say this is not figurative language, then according to the literary sense in this word, is Jesus not God then? Is Jesus not a God? Is only the Father God? That is what I am saying is a danger in not admitting to the figurative language of the God. If you do not admit that this verse is figurative in nature, be careful. In all literary sense, you will have to admit that Jesus Christ is not God and only the Father is God. Let these verses open your eyes, because these are the figurative languages of the Lord Jesus Christ. One more verse similar to that I'll throw unto you. 1 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 6. For us there is one God the Father, of whom are all things and we for Him. What does it say? There is one God the Father, of whom are all things and we for Him. And one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we live. If there are two persons there, according to your literary sense of reading, then that one God is none other than the Father. Then who's that one Lord Jesus Christ? Is not Jesus Christ God? Because if you deny this and claim that Jesus never spoke in a figurative language, then you might as well close the sermon and do something else, I'm telling you. Because if you are adamant and you say Jesus never spoke in a figurative language, brother, everything, Father, Son, everything is just two persons, three persons. If you are gonna be adamant, there's no point listening to the sermon. You might as well close this and listen to something here. Because I'm not here to please people. I'm here to warn from the coming wrath of God. And the only way to do so, to flee from the coming wrath of God, is to be baptized in the proper name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And according to Galatians chapter 3 verse 27, you have to be clothed in Christ. I am doing a ministry of John the Baptist here. I am warning everyone to flee from the wrath of the coming Lord. Yes, that's why it's very important to understand the spirit of truth as in John chapter 14 to 16. Because we need to understand the figurative language of Jesus Christ when He ministered in this world. And without understanding this figurative language of Jesus Christ, we will be lost. I'm telling you, because this sermon that we are going to start now with John chapter 14, I want you to question and examine each and every verse. Because your duty and my duty throughout the sermon will be to question each and every verse that we will be reading and check it whether it contradicts with the known truth. Amen. That is why I said that before we start with John 14, between John 14 chapter 1 to 13, Jesus is explaining in a figurative language that He is the Father God Himself. I'm telling you, this particular sermon, you have to read John chapter 14, 15, 16. Maybe if you haven't read it, I'm telling you, pause this sermon, go read those chapters, and then come back again and listen to it. Because I'm not here for your likes and for your views over here. I'm here so that I can make the people, the little people, the small amount of people who are listening, to make them understand the mystery in the Word of God. Amen. But here, Jesus in John chapter 14, He is actually explaining in a figurative language to the disciples. But we do not know whether the disciples were able to comprehend it at that point of time. Most probably they did not understand it. Because this is where Jesus is hiding a lot of things. But unto them to whom He reveals these mysteries of God, they have to be seekers of the great treasure in the Word of God. Amen. So let's see what happens in John chapter 14 verse 1 to 13. And before we read this John chapter 14 verse 1 to 13, we will also focus on John chapter 13 and find out what is the background to this John chapter 14. Okay, so in John chapter 13, Jesus had just announced that one of the disciples is going to betray Him. And He also points out to Judas and He says, Judas, you will be the betrayer. But the disciples never understood it. See, that's the thing. Jesus was probably talking to them in a figurative language that they did not even understand. When Jesus pointed out to Judas as a betrayer, they didn't know whether Jesus was talking in a plain speech or it was a figurative language. Amen. And later on in John chapter 13, in that same passage, Jesus is announcing his departure and he's proclaiming his death. So he told his disciples these words, John chapter 13 and verse 33, "Little children, I shall be with you a little while longer, and then where I'm going, you cannot come." And he's saying that he's going to depart from them. And this must have really troubled the disciples to a great extent, because that is what we see in John chapter 14 verses 1 to 13. Amen. Now remember this background. Jesus said that somebody is going to betray him, and he's saying that I'm going to be taken away from you. The disciples were troubled. So the background to the John chapter 14 is Jesus is addressing a troubled group of disciples here, and we can see that clearly over here. In chapter 13, towards the end, Simon Peter is saying to him, "Lord, seems like you're going. Where are you going?" And Jesus is answering him, saying, "Where I'm going, Peter, you cannot follow me. But there will be a day when you shall follow me afterward." But Peter is proud and adamant. He's saying, "No, Lord, wherever you're going, until death I will follow you." And the Lord wanted to put a full stop to Peter. He says, "Until I say to you, the rooster shall not crow till you denied me three times." Amen. And in John chapter 14, we come to the first part. We see Thomas. Thomas is having a doubt because Jesus said, "In my Father's house there are many mansions, and if it were not so, I would not have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. I'll come again and receive you to myself." Now Thomas is assuming that these many mansions that Jesus is talking is about a kingdom, a physical kingdom. See, but we saw last week, it is not a physical kingdom. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you. The kingdom of God is bestowed upon you. So Thomas is assuming it's a physical place, and he's saying, "Lord, Lord, if you are going, then how can we know the way?" And this is the kind of confusion. Even if we were in that situation, we would have never understood what Jesus was saying. Because today we have all the literature in front of us. We are able to comprehend. But those days, Thomas never had an idea. So he was asking, "Where is that mansion of yours? If you're going, how can we know the way?" But Jesus is assuring them. And they're all troubled here. They're all a bit troubled because Jesus is saying he's going to leave. And that's why Jesus is saying to Thomas, "Don't worry, Thomas. I am the way, the truth, and the life." Okay. And that is how Jesus is answering to Thomas. And then the next passage, Philip. See, these are all the troubled disciples. They're all confused now. They now want to know everything about Jesus. So he asked the greatest doubt of them all, Philip. He said to Jesus in verse 8, it says, 14 and verse 8, "Lord, show us the Father and it's sufficient for us." So many days you've been talking about the Father, and you said that I have to do everything as per my Father's command. And you've been talking about the Father. "Lord, show us that Father and it is sufficient for us." And Jesus replies, saying, "Have I not been with you so long, and yet have you not known me, Philip? He who has seen me, if you had seen me, you have seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father?" Here Jesus is assuring the troubled fathers, and he's assuring them that he is the Father. And in verse 7, Jesus saying, "If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And look at this. And from now on, you know him." That is, he's telling the disciples that you know him and you have seen him. How could have the disciples seen the Father? They could have never had seen the Father. Nobody sees the Father and lives. But if they had seen him, that means Jesus is pointing out to himself and saying, "I am the Father. If you had seen me, you had seen the Father." Hallelujah. Now, this is a troubled scenario where all the disciples are fretting that the Lord Jesus Christ is going to leave them. But here is where you see Jesus is assuring and promising in love that he has for his disciples that he is the one who is going to be coming as the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Now, this is the entire context of this chapter 14. Jesus sees that these guys are all troubled and they're all fretting. and they want some consolation. They want some assuring words. So Jesus is in a mixed language, in a figurative language. Sometimes he reveals it a bit. Sometimes he hides it a bit, conceals it a bit. But it's really amazing when you read the passage this way, because Jesus is actually telling the disciples that I'm going to come again. I'll be that Holy Spirit. You may ask, how can you say that? That's what we're going to meditate upon. John chapter 14 and verse 16 to 18. We read John chapter 14 and verse 16. See, many teachers of the word of God, I've seen them read John chapter 14 and verse 16, but they'll omit the next two verses. They'll either read it and blindly just ignore it. But we're going to read it fully. And John chapter 16 says, and I will pray the Father that he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. And Jesus is saying, I will not leave you as orphans. Not the Holy Spirit will come to you. I will come to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is what I'm saying. He is speaking in a mixed tone. A little bit of revelations, a little bit of concealment. He's speaking in a figurative language. I've already explained this many times in my previous sermons as well. But many teachers of the word will only concentrate on the first part of the message. But I'm telling you, the second part of the message is where the truth lies to. Who is the Spirit of truth? Now question yourself, why does it say that the world cannot receive the Spirit of truth? That's what the word of God says there. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. After all, I thought that this Spirit of truth is the Holy Spirit which is promised unto us, whom we are supposed to receive in our hearts. So what does it talk about? Question yourself. This is what Jesus is talking about. The Spirit of truth, he is referring to himself, which the world later on cannot receive. They neither see him nor knows him. But he's saying that this Spirit of truth, who's me, you know him. That is to the disciples saying, three things he's saying. You know him. He dwells with you. He not dwells in you. That means it's a spirit that dwells in them. No, Jesus is saying it dwells with. It's a physical parameter. If you dwell in somebody's house, I'm dwelling with that person's house. That is what he's saying. I'm dwelling with you in this world. And the third point Jesus is saying, and will be in you. That means a future. That is Jesus saying that you know him, that is me, for he dwells with you, that is me, and he will be in you, that is also me. I'm going to be in you. And in verse 18, he summarizes saying, I will not leave you as orphans. Come on, do not be troubled. I will come to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do you understand what Jesus is doing here? Jesus is consoling the disciples. Jesus is loosening up a little bit from the figurative language that he has always been talking to them. And he's saying that he's not going to leave them, but he is the Spirit of truth that is going to come into them. Hallelujah. The Spirit of truth is nothing but Jesus Christ. And John chapter 14 and verse 26 says, and that day you will know. This is what he's saying. See, again, a figurative language. That day you will know that I am in my Father and you in me and I in you. Many people will tell me, no, this is not figurative language. Then you have to also explain John chapter 16 and verse 26, which we saw. These things I spoke to you in a figurative language. Jesus said that. What things? These are the things that Jesus spoke to you in a figurative language. These are the verses that Jesus spoke to you in a figurative language. And at that day you will know that I am in my Father, you in me, and I in you. This is Jesus clearly, don't get confused, this is Jesus clearly portraying the kingdom of God. The Spirit of God is in Jesus. And similarly, the Spirit of Christ, which is the Spirit of truth, we just saw that, is in us. That is what Jesus is saying. Just like how I am in the Spirit of my Father, similarly, you should be in the Spirit of Christ in me. And to understand that, every verse will have a twin verse. This is exactly what Jesus is promising to all the overcomers in the church of Laodicea. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 21 says, to him who overcomes, I'll grant to sit with me on my throne as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. How many thrones were there in heaven? Only one throne. So do you mean to say Jesus, the Father was sitting on a throne and then Jesus came and sat on the throne and then you also, as Jesus promised, went and sat on Jesus' throne? No. What does that mean? It's the same thing what John chapter 14 and verse 26 is saying, that you will sit on my, that as I sat on with my Father on my throne, means that I'm sitting with my Father's glory, with the Spirit of the Lord on the Father's throne. That is only one person there. And how will we be sitting with Jesus Christ on his throne? That means we'll be sharing the glory of the Lord, the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of truth in us, meaning the kingdom of God has been bestowed upon us and we will be sitting on a throne. Because once the kingdom of God is upon us, we are chosen to be as kings and priests. Hallelujah. You have to understand this mighty truth, my dear brothers and sisters. Otherwise, we will never. If you don't understand, if you claim that this is not a figurative language of the Lord, I'm telling you, might as well turn it off, watch something else. But those days, the disciples could not understand it yet. They could not comprehend. They were confused. They were troubled. The next person to be in trouble was Judas. This is not the Judas Iscariot who betrayed Jesus, the other Judas. John chapter 14 and verse 22 is saying, Lord, how is that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? This is another physical realm he's talking about. How can you manifest yourself to us and not to the world? And Jesus is answering to him, John chapter 14 verse 23, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word and my Father will love him. What does it mean? He'll keep my word means he'll keep the Spirit of the Lord. The word is nothing. The spoken word which was commanded after the Lord, which created the heavens and the earth, as per Psalm 103, is nothing but the Spirit of the Lord that was commanded from the Lord's mouth. So he will keep my spirit and the Father will love him and we will come to him and make our home with us. We will come to him and make our home with us. Now this we will come is what many people who are in the Trinity doctrine will come and pull down to me, and they say we will come to him and make our home with us. But again, I'm telling you, this entire sermon, you'll have to question. These are all figurative languages of the Lord Jesus Christ. John chapter 16, 26, he says, all these things I've spoken to you in a figurative language. So this verse is also a figurative language. So we will come to him and make our home with us. You have to question yourself, who was promised to come into your hearts? Who was promised to come into all our hearts? The Father and the Son or the Spirit of God? Read everywhere in the Word of God and you'll only find that the Spirit of God was promised into our hearts and not the Father and the Son. Yes, and many verses you can find. One such verse I'm just going to pull out, Ezekiel chapter 37 and verse 14. I will put my Spirit in you and you shall live. Hallelujah. And I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, says the Lord. Hallelujah. So who's putting his Spirit in you? The Lord. Who's the Lord? The Lord Jesus Christ. And this is what parallels John chapter 12 and verse 49, in which we read that the Father gave a command and his command is everlasting life. But who's spoken the command here and performed it? The Lord Jesus Christ. And he's saying that he will put his Spirit in us. Hallelujah. So here we see that everlasting life is given by the Spirit of the Lord, and the Lord himself is speaking and performing it. Not the Father, not our Son. It is not we will come and dwell. That means, what does this verse mean? We will come and dwell. This can only mean that Jesus is referring to the Father and Son being in the Spirit of the same God. This Father and Son are not names. They are not persons. They are manifestations. Manifestations of the same God. The diversities of the same, the diversities of works of the same God. He was a counselor to you. He was a father to you. He was a son to you. He will be a redeemer to you. He will be a judge in the later days. And he'll be a king. These are all the manifestation, the diversities of the same God. So what is that Spirit that's going to come into you? That we will come and dwell is nothing but the Spirit of truth. We read that in Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord will come upon you. And that is why Jesus sums it finally to make his disciples understand that the Holy Spirit, see, Jesus went on talking. The disciples still weren't convinced. They were still crying. They were weeping. They were troubled and they were very fretted up. And this is why Jesus is stepping up a little bit and he's saying, John chapter 14, verse 26. This should open your eyes, my dear brothers and sisters. Jesus is again telling the disciples, see, I'm telling you again, because he's already said before that I will send a helper. But again, he's saying, the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. Hallelujah. What is this Lord Jesus Christ saying over there? The helper, the Holy Spirit, is going to come to you. Listen, do not be troubled. That helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father sent, will be sent in my name. So open your eyes. See that this Holy Spirit is none other than the Spirit of the Lord, which is the Spirit of truth, which is Jesus Christ himself. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! My dear brothers and sisters, your eyes have to be open. How can you deny this verse? The Helper, the Holy Spirit, which many people consider is a third person in the Trinity, but Jesus is saying, be not be troubled. Listen carefully. Listen carefully, disciples. The Father will send that Helper, the Holy Spirit, in my name. So do not be troubled. Understand who's going to come unto you. What is Jesus saying? That the Holy Spirit that's going to be sent unto them is none other than Jesus Christ himself. He's going to come. And that is why I'm saying we have to confirm this with the word of God. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 13. The same John who wrote the Gospel of John in one of his epistles, he's now saying, 1 John chapter 4 verse 13, by this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. Hallelujah! Who's saying this? John is saying, by this we know that we abide in him. That is what the Lord Jesus Christ said. Like how I am in my Father and my Father in you and you in me. That is what John is saying. As we abide in him, but here he's saying in more clearer terms, and he in us, who's in us? Jesus Christ in us, the Lord God Yahweh in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. Not multiple spirits. Not like we will come and dwell. Not two persons, three persons. One single Spirit, his Spirit. Hallelujah. Jesus has given us his Spirit to abide in us. And this is the Spirit of truth. And this Spirit of truth is the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is the Spirit that will bring peace into our hearts. Hallelujah. Yeah, Jesus is again consoling his disciples. John chapter 14, verse 27. Peace I leave with you. Disciples, do not cry. Do not be tormented. Do not be afraid. Peace I leave with you. And my peace I give to you. What is this my peace? Peace I leave with you. He's saying peace. That is the external peace he's saying. And my peace I give to you. So what are these two entities? The first peace I leave with you is all your earthly peace the Lord is talking about. And my peace I give to you is nothing but the Spirit of the Lord, which is going to be given unto you. Not as of the world gives do I give to you. So do not let your hearts be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a powerful statement. Hallelujah. Jesus is consoling his disciples over here. See, they were troubled. They were troubled. Look at all the kind of... the thing is that the droughts and all the lamentations they had. They were lamenting. But Jesus is assuring them that his peace is going to be given unto them. That means the Spirit of truth, which is the Lord Jesus Christ, will be given unto them. Hallelujah. And that is where we have to see that Philippians chapter 4 and verse 7 says, and the peace of God, And the peace of the Lord God, what is that? That is the Spirit of the Lord God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah! What an amazing revelation by the Lord Jesus Christ. My dear brothers and sisters, I pray that your eyes will be open. Because if you do not understand the figurative language of the Lord, if you are in denial, I'm telling you, let that spiritual blindness be removed right now from your eyes. Because the Lord at this time is saying in John chapter 16, 26, all these things, what John chapter 14, 15, 16, 13, all these things are spoken to you in a figurative language. But there will come a time when I will no longer speak to you in a figurative language, but I will talk to you plainly about the Father. Hallelujah. So let us all surrender our lives to this peace that the Lord Jesus Christ is giving unto us. Let's close our eyes and ask the Lord to humbly open our hearts. Right now, let our hearts not be like the heart of Pharaoh, but let the finger of God work among you. Let the Spirit of God, the power of God, let it work amongst us. Ask God to open our eyes that we will receive the revelation and the fullness of the gospel of Christ. And Lord Jesus Christ is gonna be with us in the Spirit of the Lord and the Spirit of the truth. And He is gonna give us a peace that passeth all understanding. And when we surrender in His presence, the Lord is always there to lift us up. The Lord is always there to pick us up. The Lord is always there to bestow upon us a kingdom. The Lord is always there to remove us from all the troubles from this earth. The Lord is always there to remove us from all our financial situations. The Lord is always there to bind the broken hearts. The Lord is always there to heal the troublesome and to heal the wounded. And the Lord is always there to bind the broken families. The Lord is always there to bring us all together to His kingdom. And that is what the Lord wants us at this point of time to become partakers of His kingdom. And to be partakers of this kingdom, the Lord wants to fill upon you His Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth upon you. May the Spirit of truth fill you right now. May the Spirit of truth, Lord Jesus, pour upon your people. And Lord, in the last days, you said, Lord Father, that you will pour upon your Spirit upon all the people. My Jesus, I pray that as I stretch out my hand, that your Spirit, Lord Father, will be poured upon each and every person who's listening to the word of God, that you will restore them, that you will lift them up, that you will lift them up on high and exalt them above every other name as well. And my Jesus, we will share the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we will be in you and in spirit with the Father, Lord. And my Jesus, your kingdom will be a kingdom that will not vanish away. Your kingdom will not be defeated. But Lord, we will forever, forever, forever be victorious and stand upright in your kingdom, Lord. My Jesus, heal us, Lord. Deliver us from all evil and bring us closer to your flock. My Jesus, I pray, Lord Jesus, that people, Lord Father, will understand that their eyes have to be open. That spiritual blindness cannot exist in them anymore. My Jesus, open their eyes and let them come into the knowledge and understanding that we need to be baptized under your name. And Lord, I commit that each and every person, Lord Father, that your Spirit will speak unto them, that your Spirit will reveal all the marvelous things in the Word of God and rightly divide everything, Lord Jesus. Lord, we appoint ourselves, Lord Father, to be stewards to the Word of God. And my Jesus, you lead us. My Jesus, you be our light. And my Jesus, you hold our hands as we walk, and Lord, lead us into your mighty kingdom, Lord. That is all that we desire, and that is all that we ask of you at this moment, Lord. My Jesus, we want to belong to you. We want to be children of God. We want to be bearers of the Spirit of God. We want to be appointed to be bestowed upon us a kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, for that, Lord Father, we humble ourselves and surrender before your presence. Lord, take us as we are. For we are your children. Take us, Lord Jesus. Take us in your mighty and matchless name, we pray. Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all on his benefits. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you everlasting peace, the peace that passeth all understanding, and the peace the Spirit of God may fill your hearts. In Jesus' mighty name, Amen. Amen. My dear brothers and sisters, I pray that the Word of God would have opened your eyes. I'm telling you, this is not a joke. You have to open your eyes, because these are the last days. Do not be destroyed for lack of knowledge. And if you're a follower of the Tamil language, please tune in every Sunday morning, 10:30 a.m. for the Tamil service. The Lord Jesus Christ is using my dad, Brother Stephen Senadhipathi, in a very, very, very mighty way. And the words that you will probably listen to in those sermons are something which you probably wouldn't have heard. See, I'm not proclaiming my dad's ministry here. I'm proclaiming the Word of God, testifying over the Word of God. If you want to listen to the Word of God, keep tuning in, subscribe, and share this video with many people. Let many eyes be opened. Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you all. Goodbye.
There is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved is proven itself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like us. All our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved, he's proven himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like us. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the of ages, Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like us. There is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation cannot be moved, he's proven himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like us. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock.